Well, thanks for joining us today on this, I call it Triskaidekaphobia Day. It's Friday the 13th, and in case you don't know, that's for people that have a fear of Friday the 13th. I actually kind of look forward to them, and from what I understand, this may be the only one we have this year. That's kind of an oddity. And we have a little bit of an oddity in our USDA overnight reporting as well. We have multiple U.S. overnight sales. And let's take a look at what we have here on the Flash Export Sales Report this morning. It is soybeans, and it is two counts of them. Soybeans, 326,200 tons to unknown destinations. Now, it is split up, and we have part of it is reserved for the old crop, 200 tons of that. That 200 of 326,200, that's reserved for old crop. The rest of it, 326,000 tons, is for new crop. Now, that's kind of interesting. How are they going to divide that thing up? Export sales of 126,000 tons of soybeans are specifically to China once again. So they're back in there for the current marketing year. And I just thought that was interesting. Wanted to point that out. So we're talking over 440,000 or 450,000 tons of soybeans sold overnight. That's getting to be quite a run. We have Brian Hoops on the line. He's president of Midwest Market Solutions. Brian, what is that, 7 days in a row now?
Yeah, good morning, Marlon. It is 7 consecutive days of soybean sales, and I don't know that we're done. You know, we talked earlier in the week that China was rumored to be a pretty big buyer of U.S. soybeans, and that would be reflected in upcoming days. And so while we've had 7 sales, they've bought as much as 30 cargoes of U.S. soybeans. That's the rumors anyway. And so we may see some more sales early part of next week to kind of complete their buying. But, you know, I thought it was an interesting overnight market as we kind of sold off yesterday after the report had been digested. And the overnight markets were lower until maybe 3 o'clock, 3:30, and then we started to rally. Some international buyers stepped into the marketplace, some fundamental trading was being done, trying to get some coverage, extended coverage around them, and that lifted prices. And so you saw a pretty strong rally, but it was in the last 3 or 4 hours of the morning session. And now we always look to whether we can build on that during the day session or not. And you saw wheat at contract highs this morning. So obviously that market is very strong. When you make contract highs, that's certainly not bearish. But it's the corn and soybeans I'm a little more concerned about today. We have, you know, a pretty big range yesterday. We need to take out the top end of that range, I think, to attract a lot more technical buying interest.
I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah, there was a lot of concern at the close yesterday when we had that big reversal to the upside right after the report came out, and you had, what was it, like a half dollar range or something like that in soybeans. And then it all failed right at the close, and I think we barely closed maybe a penny higher. Boy, did that raise a lot of caution flags. And then overnight we started out lower and everybody went, uh-oh, and now here we are higher again this morning. It's really hard to figure this thing out. Let's look at where we now stand on the corn. Overnight, as you mentioned, December finished the Globex trade 7.25 higher at 580.5 overnight. In the soybean trade, with our quotes provided by Bar Chart, November came back and closed 14.75 higher at 13.55¾. I'm sure this overnight sales probably won't hurt that any. And in the wheat in Chicago, December 17.25 higher at 782. Kansas City, December finished 14.25 higher at 765. And in spring wheat, well, here you had December 15.75 higher at 934.75. By the way, in the cotton market overnight, December was down 17 points. We'll come back and talk with Brian about our livestock trade on a Friday when we come back. We are back with Brian Hoops of Midwest Market Solutions, and we're going to talk a little livestock market action right now. Brian, I want to review how we finished up in the cattle and hog markets yesterday and get your thought on what that may mean for today. They had a lot to contend with the USDA reports yesterday, with that big rally you had in the corn. You had to wonder how much pressure that would put on them. And if you look at the live cattle trade on the big board, we had everything closing higher. October was up 92 at 128.50. I thought that was interesting. By the way, we had huge gains again in the beef cutout values yesterday. September feeders were 72 cents higher at 163.55, even though the corn was sharply higher. I was intrigued by that. on the lean hogs. Yesterday, we finished with the October contract 62 cents higher at 86.47, and December was up a dollar. Lots of stuff going on here affecting the livestock trade. And Brian, yesterday we had the beef and pork export sales that came out from USDA, and they weren't very exciting at all. And yet we closed higher against the odds. How'd that happen?
Yeah, those export sales weren't all that exciting, but you look at some of the other fundamental news, it was pretty friendly for cattle. Finally, there was some breakout in the cash markets in the Southern Plains. There was some trade all the way up to 125. Not a tremendous amount of head, but it was enough to attract the trade's attention. Most of the volume is going to be in that 122 range, 121, 122, pretty much in line with the August futures. But, you know, you look at the longer-term fundamentals, steer weights were down 14 pounds compared to a year ago. They were down 3 pounds last week, 14 compared to last year. So we've got a lot less tonnage coming at the market. At the same time, we've been pulling cattle ahead. We've got the tighter supplies coming here in this third and fourth quarters. And that's what those deferred contracts are keying off on, is we have, you know, big surge in boxed beef, plus lighter weights, plus you know, these tighter numbers, and it adds up to higher prices, with the only caveat being, you know, what happens with COVID and the economy. And, you know, producers can manage that risk by using some put options and leaving the upside wide open, protecting their downside.
Brian, how were deliveries this morning on the cattle?
Yeah, you know, in this price level, you're not going to see much of any deliveries, because we're pretty much in line with that cash. It's if the futures market takes off and rallies, that's where you can start to see some more deliveries, unless the cash comes up. So we're not real concerned about the deliveries. There has been some in the last couple days. Right today, August hogs go off the board along with the futures and options both expire. Should mention that could affect the hog market a little bit, as October kind of needs to align itself with the lean hog index, as August is going to be expiring with today's close.
Great information. I'm glad you pointed that out. Appreciate it. Brian, thanks. You have a good weekend out there. Brian Hoops of Midwest Market Solutions. Tammy, it should be an exciting day. We'll have the trade starting at the bottom of the hour. Back to you.